Hi, I'm Jeffrey, and right now we are going to look at the book of Joshua and see how its structure tells us what it's all about. Now, if you're familiar with the Bible, then you know that the Bible falls into two large sections. There's the Old Testament, which looks at the relationship between ancient Israel and their God, and then there's the New Testament, which looks at the teachings and life of Jesus and those who followed after him. Now, the book of Joshua falls early on in the Old Testament. It's the sixth book of the Old Testament, right after the first five, which are considered the books of Moses, or the Pentateuch, or the Torah. Now, Joshua kicks off a new leg of the Old Testament. The Torah ends at the end of the book of Deuteronomy. And then we find ourselves in this part of the Bible that the ancients called the prophets. And modern Christians tend to call these books of history. But what that means is Joshua begins the story that explores how the ancient nation of Israel played out their relationship with God after they made some agreements with him back in the Torah, or those first five books of the Bible. So if we're going to understand the book of Joshua, we really need to understand the Torah. Now, I have a video that covers the Torah at a high level, and then also videos on each one of the five books of the Torah. So you can check those out to get a refresher. But here's what's important for us to know for the book of Joshua. So Joshua begins with the death of Moses. Well, Moses died at the end of Deuteronomy, which is the last book of the Torah. And that's after everything that all of Israel's origin story has taken place. So in the book of Genesis, we find ourselves in this situation where there are many nations and they have their own gods, and these nations have their own lands. And out of all of these nations worshiping all of these other deities, the God that becomes the God of Israel chooses a man named Abram, changes his name to Abraham, and promises that through him, he will not only give Abraham a land of his own, his descendants will inherit a promised land, but also through Abraham, all the nations of the world will be blessed. He makes this promise to Abraham in the book of Genesis. Well, later on in the book of Exodus, Abraham's descendants find themselves enslaved in Egypt. They're not in the land that God promised to their ancestors. And so the book of Exodus tells the story of Israel's God rescuing Israel, not only from the humans of Egypt, but as far as the ancient Israelites believed, he rescued them from the gods of Egypt as well. So you have one God that goes to war with the gods of Egypt to ransom this people group out. And then once Israel is rescued from Egypt through very, very large scale miracles, then they make a pact with this God in the wilderness. And we call this God, God, through the rest of the Bible. So that's what I'm referring to. God rescues Israel in this dramatic scene where he parts the waters of the Red Sea and they get to pass on dry ground, which is going to be mirrored very soon in the book of Joshua. Then God leads Israel through the wilderness on their way to the promised land. But the generation of Israelites that God rescued forfeits the promised land. They choose not to go in. And so rather than allow them to go back into Egypt and allow further generations to be enslaved, God holds them in the wilderness for 40 years so that the next generation can choose whether or not they're going to trust God, remain loyal to him, and take the land, or make the same mistake that their fathers and mothers did. So that's where the Torah ends. We have the first generation is dead, and then the next generation is given a choice by Moses. They can be loyal to God, and that's choosing life. They'll enjoy life and blessings in this promised land. Or they can forsake God's laws and choose death and destruction and curses for themselves. Moses dies, Joshua is designated leader, and the whole Torah closes with Israel needing to choose whether or not they are going to be loyal to God and enjoy life and blessings, or forsake him and face the consequences. So all that happens, and then in the book of Joshua, it opens up with Moses has died, and then God reaffirms to Joshua that he is going to be with him as they take the land. And when we look at the book of Joshua, it pretty nicely falls into four sections. And those four sections mirror each other in certain ways. The book of Joshua is 24 chapters long, and although those chapters were added by people long, long after this book was written, they help us make sense of dividing the book pretty nicely, because the first 12 chapters, so the first half, is kind of this part one where we see the conquest of the promised land. And then the second part deals more with the covenants that God has made. A covenant is an ancient, solemn, binding pact between two or more parties that joins them together. And so that's what we're really going to be looking at here. So, and then not only do we have the first half and the second half following certain themes, but also we have some themes that run parallel in the quarters of the book of Joshua. So the first section of part one and the first section of part two are both going to be really heavily focused on entering and possessing the land of Canaan. And then the second parts of part one and two are going to really look at the choices that people make and whether or not they are loyal to God. So let's jump into the book of Joshua. In the first five chapters of Joshua, that's our first section, we see the people of Israel finally entering the land of Canaan after wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. And so we have God recommissioning Joshua. He's already said in the Torah that Joshua is going to lead the people, but God tells Joshua that he will at the beginning of this book. We meet a prostitute named Rahab, and this is a very interesting figure because Rahab is not an Israelite. She's not part of this nation. She's not in this covenant relationship with God that that he has with the people of Israel. But she's heard about the miracles that Israel's God worked on Israel's behalf when he rescued them from Egypt and protected them through the promised land. And so this woman, Rahab, helps two spies that Joshua sends into the promised land. He says to the two spies, go in, check it out. They go in there and Rahab helps them hide. She shelters them. Pays off for Rahab very nicely later on. And then we have this dramatic scene of the people of Israel on the east side of the Jordan. They're going to cross into the promised land on the west side. And then God parts the Jordan River. He stops the river waters, and the people of Israel are able to pass through on dry ground. Again, mirroring the miracles that we saw God act in on Israel's behalf in the book of Exodus. So it's a reaffirmation that Israel's God is with them and will help them possess this land. He will make good on his promises. We see the people of Israel commemorating, they're rededicating themselves to this covenant. The men are circumcised. They observe the Feast of Passover, which commemorates the time when God passed over the Israelites when he was judging the Egyptians back in Exodus. So we have a lot of good focus here while the Israelites are entering the land of Canaan. And then once they start eating the food of the land of Canaan, the manna stops. Manna, if you're familiar with the Torah, was this miraculous food that came down from heaven. It was bread from heaven that God fed the Israelites with. And so they get into the land and manna stops. They start enjoying the fruit of the land. And then at the end of this section, we see a very interesting scene that is the key to understanding the rest of the book of Joshua and really the rest of the prophets in the Old Testament. Joshua sees a man with a sword and he asks this person, are you for us or for our enemies? And the man with the sword says, neither. He says, I am the commander of the Lord's army. And so this is very, very key to understand, because God is not on Israel's side. In fact, it's going to be up to the people in the book of Joshua and up to the people in the rest of the Old Testament to make the choice, because God is not taking sides. We take sides. And so this is going to play out throughout the rest of the book of Joshua. It's a very, very important scene in the book of Joshua and for the rest of the Old Testament. So let's jump into the second section of part one. This is chapters 6 through 12. And this is where we see a lot of the action happening. The famous battle of Jericho, in which the people of Israel just walk around the city wall, and then God miraculously brings the city down. God is the one fighting on behalf of Israel in this section. And so we see these series of divine victories. We see miracles. We have victories being won by Israel's God. And we see that there are a few things that happen as the Israelites take possession of the land. Those who choose to side with God are protected. Remember Rahab, who protected the spies that Joshua sent in. She sides with God. She sides with Israel. She integrates with Israel, and she is spared during the Battle of Jericho. But on the other hand, Achan, who is one of the Israelites, rejects God's commands, and he endangers the rest of the Israelite camp, and he dies in a rather tragic fashion. He is not protected by God in that situation, because those who oppose God end up getting destroyed in the book of Joshua. So we see this happening at a personal level, but then we start seeing this at a larger scale. So there's a group of people called the Gibeonites, and they ally themselves with Israel. They hear Israel's coming in. They have a very powerful God. They're going to wipe out everyone that doesn't align themselves with them. And through some clever trickery, they get Israel to not destroy them, and they align themselves with Israel, and they survive. They are protected. But the other 31 kings that come up against Joshua, they don't submit, they fight, and they lose, and they're wiped out. Now, when I say wiped out, it's important, if you're going to be reading through the book of Joshua, to understand that there's a lot of hyperbolic language that happens in battles. You'll find things like they were driven out completely, or you know, they killed everything that breathed. They were destroyed. But then we see some of those people groups cropping up again later on in the book of Judges, or even later on in the book of Joshua. So these are not necessarily absolute when we're talking about things getting, or people groups getting completely wiped out. So that's just a good thing to keep in mind, because you're going to see some of these people groups crop up again later on in the Old Testament. It's interesting to note that just like God wasn't only rescuing Israel from the humans of Egypt, but was also rescuing Israel from the gods of Egypt, we also see God overthrowing the spiritual forces at play in Canaan. And we're going to see this more and more throughout the Old Testament as God confronts the deities of the other people groups in Canaan. You'll find some language throughout the Torah and in the book of Joshua and later on in Samuel that talk about the Nephilim or the Anakim. And these are spiritual human forces that deserve a video all unto themselves. But that's just an interesting thing for you to keep in mind as we're going through the book of Joshua, because God is not just, this isn't just about humans versus humans. This is really happening on a divine stage. That wraps up part one of Joshua, where we see them conquering the land. Now let's look at part two, which focuses more on the covenants that God and the people of Israel have made and how they're fulfilled. So the first one, in the first part of part two, this is chapters 13 through 22. Not the most exciting part of the Bible, but important nonetheless. So, a quick history lesson. You have the nation of Israel, which is made up of 12 tribes. Those tribes came from the 12 sons of Jacob, who was called Israel, who was the son of Isaac, who was the son of Abraham. So, remember, back in Genesis, God promised Abraham a land. Well, now we're seeing that promise come true. In Joshua chapters 13 through 22, we have Joshua assigning land and territory to the 12 tribes. So 9.5 tribes take land east of Jordan, 2.5 tribes were given land west of Jordan by Moses back in Deuteronomy, and then a couple of caveats. The tribe of Levi doesn't get a physical territory unto themselves. That's because their inheritance was maintaining the tabernacle for Israel's God. And so while Levi doesn't get the territory, the descendants of Joseph get two territories. So the math works out. Two tribes came from Joseph. Those are Ephraim and Manasseh. And you can learn more about this in Genesis 48 and 49 and Deuteronomy 33. Lots of blessings and descriptions of these tribes. In the last part of Joshua, although it's only two chapters long, these are very, very important chapters for understanding the rest of the Old Testament. So here we have Joshua renewing the covenant that Moses made with the people at the end of Deuteronomy. And we have Joshua, again, reviewing Israel's history. We get a quick recap of the Torah. And Joshua says, your ancestors used to serve many different gods back in Abraham's homeland. And you've been under the captivity of Egypt's gods, and you're moving into a new land with people groups that have their own gods. You need to choose this day whom you will serve. Are you going to serve the gods of the land that you've moved into? Are you going to serve ancient gods from Mesopotamia? Or are you going to serve the God that brought you here to this land? And so he presents the choice. Again, like, God is not for Israel necessarily. Israel needs to choose whether or not they are for God. And so he says, you can choose life and blessing, or you can choose death and curses if you're disloyal to God. He presents that choice to the next generation, just like Moses presented the choice to the one beforehand. And the next generation, they need to choose, and they swear they're going to serve God. How does that work out? Well, it's a little ambiguous in the book of Joshua, but that's what we have the book of Judges for. So in the last couple of verses of Joshua, we set the stage for the rest of what are called the former prophets. So former prophets are Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and Kings. And this helps us see how things are going to go for the rest of this group of the Bible. Joshua dies. And while when Moses died, Joshua was named successor, there's no successor named to take Joshua's place. It's on the people to serve God. Joseph's bones are buried way back in Genesis. He said that, you know, Joseph died in Egypt and he wanted to be buried in the land of Israel. And so that finally comes to pass. Phinehas, who is the grandson of Aaron, and therefore the great nephew of Moses, becomes the new high priest when his father dies. We're going to see Phinehas briefly in the next book of the Bible. And then we get an uplifting note to end on. Israel serves God. As long as the people who were contemporaries of Moses and Joshua are alive. What happens after that? Well, that's what we have the book of Judges for, and we learn all about how things go between Israel and the God that they just promised to serve. So, that's the book of Joshua, and that's what it's all about. I hope this was helpful. If you'd like to know more about the book of Joshua and how it fits in with the rest of the books of the Bible, I would encourage you to check out my book. It's called The Beginner's Guide to the Bible, and it'll walk you through not only Joshua, but every other book, and you'll walk away with a really high-level understanding of where the Bible came from, what it's for, and what it's all about. I used Logos Bible software to make this and do all of the research that went into it, and if you want to check out my review of that, you can find a link to that in the description of this video. And if you like this video and you want to see more, then you should subscribe to this YouTube channel. That way I can notify you just as soon as the next video goes live. Again, I'm Jeffrey. Thank you so much for watching.